Good morning. This is Jenny Cummings, and I am here at the Grayson County Health Department, and I have Dr. Jillian Carden with me today from Silverleaf. And Jillian, I'm a little nervous because this is my first podcast without Josh. I've never interviewed anyone by myself.
You're going to do great. We're going to do great.
Together. I hope so. But I feel really good. If I had to do this, I'm glad it was with you because you are always a great guest. So we just wanted to let the community know that April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, but also it is also Sexual Assault Awareness Month as well. And so we are working hard here at the health department because we just really want to raise awareness in our community and let people know just some things about child abuse and neglect, and also just to talk to Dr. Jillian because she knows a lot about, just from working at Silverleaf, the sexual assault awareness component as well. And so we're just glad to have you here.
Thank you.
And to get us started, I just wondered if you could tell us a little bit about what child abuse is.
Okay, well, there's actually different forms of child abuse. Oftentimes when we think about child abuse, we automatically think about physical child abuse, right, where a child is physically being harmed. And that is one type of child abuse. However, there's also sexual abuse, when a child is being coerced or manipulated or forced into being touched or potentially touching someone else. And that might also be including watching things like pornography, being forced to watch those things. So all of those things encompass sexual abuse. And then we also have neglect.
Okay.
Neglect is when a child's basic needs are not being met.
Okay.
And that may come in the form of they're not being fed. Maybe they don't have adequate housing. Maybe they don't have adequate safety. Safety might look like something where a child is unsupervised, and maybe they're maybe out of the home, or they're kind of wandering the streets or things like that, but they don't have proper supervision, and all of those things can definitely put a child at risk.
Yeah. And how common is it?
Well, what we know specifically for sexual abuse, we know that 1 in 10 children before they turn 18 will be a victim of sexual abuse. We know that physical abuse, Kentucky ranks number one in the nation for child physical abuse.
Wow.
And we have for years. For the past decade, Kentucky has ranked either first or second in the nation for child abuse. So we know that that is a major issue for our state.
Yes. Goodness. I looked at the CDC website and saw where 1 in 7 children have experienced child abuse or neglect in the last year.
Yeah, it's a major problem. And when we think about, you know, stats, sometimes we can get kind of wrapped up in the numbers of, okay, that's just a number. But if you think about the children in your life, whether they're your own children or your neighbors or your grandchildren, but you probably know 7 children.
Right.
And so one of those children being a victim of abuse,
yes,
that's how you take that home, and it becomes important.
Yes. I think about just the size of a classroom, an average classroom in Kentucky and here in Grayson County, where if you have, you know, 25 kids, that could be 3 to 4 students.
Absolutely.
Who are the victim of abuse.
Yeah.
So it definitely happens.
Yes.
And it happens way too often. One of the things I wanted to ask you a little bit about is, what are the things that we can watch for as far as maybe being able to pick up on the fact that abuse is occurring in a home or a child is a victim of abuse?
Mm-hmm. Well, if we kind of go back to those 3 main areas, so for child physical abuse, what you're going to want to be looking for is if you're engaging with a child and you actually see bruises. Mm-hmm. And these are going to be, you know, some kids are rough and tumble and they're going to have like bumps and bruises on their knees and elbows because they're just kids. Mm-hmm. And those are going to happen. And those are pretty common. But if you see bruising on the face or the chest, if you know that this child just seems to have a lot of injuries without a whole lot of explanation, if you ask the child, you know, oh goodness, tell me what happened. And they're vague, or they say, oh, I don't know, but it's a significant enough injury that that child would know. Those are definitely things to look for. Other things, if moving on to sexual abuse, a child that maybe has really inappropriate boundaries. And so what that may look like is a child goes up and hugs and kisses on a total stranger. Or maybe a younger child is touching the body of other children. Or they may say things like, well, this is what we do at our house, or this is how we play doctor. And it seems more than what you would normally expect. Those are some things to look for with sexual abuse. As far as neglect, we're looking for those kiddos who, sometimes kids who are hungry will steal food because they may not be getting that at home, or they may be hiding food. So that may be the child in the community or at school who's stuffing extra food in their book bag or pockets because they're not sure if they're going to eat. When it comes to safety, kids that again that may not have that supervision, or maybe who look like they may have lots of bites on them that may be indicators of bed bugs. So it's not just seen, but in any of these three circumstances, I would encourage you to have a conversation with the child. We don't want to interrogate children, but to just be able to ask things about, hey, you look hungry. When's the last time you ate? Or, when you go home this afternoon, do you feel safe at your house? And probably the most important thing besides hearing or besides looking for signs is listening for signs. So if a child says, I get beat at home, or somebody's touching me and I don't like it, the very best thing that we can do is listen and believe. So that's, I would say that's the number one thing. It's not just watching for signs, but it is listening for signs.
And I remember when you did our podcast in January, and you told us just as far as looking, we were talking about sexual abuse, but we talked about the most important thing you can say is, I believe you. And that I will take that with me forever. That's it's always important to say, I believe you.
Even if, a child tells you something and you're in your head thinking, maybe that's not the way it really happened. Nope, I just want you to put that to the side and I want you to tell that child, I believe you, and we're gonna figure this out.
That's great. Something else, just kind of moving on, to help with prevention of child abuse and to empower families to protect their kiddos. There's something that we call, and I come from a home visiting background, that we call protective factors. And these are things that we can instill in our children and that we can help them with that give them what they need. So that they have that self-esteem and that they have the power to be able to talk to you when something happens, if they are, because there are things that happen in the home, obviously, but there are also times our children are in the care of other people, and we need to give them the power to be able to speak for themselves and to communicate that. So if you could talk to us a little bit about what can we do to empower our kids as families, what can we do?
Yeah, I think probably the most powerful thing that you can do with your children, regardless of how old they are, is to have the conversation often about their bodies and also about consent. Now, this is going to look really different depending on the age of the child, but if you have a toddler, now is the time to start with that. And a really specific example that is very important in our work with kids is that you teach children what the name of their body part is and using the correct name. Families have lots and lots of nicknames
They
for body
do.
parts.
They do. And it's so important. And I don't think I realized until I got into working in public health how important that is, because when I went to a training one time and they talked about it, when we don't use those correct words, we insinuate that there is shame in those real words, that there's something wrong with using those real words. And so we need to call them something else. And I remember going to a training and it changed how I felt about it forever, because they gave an example of a little girl who was in a early education program who kept telling her her teacher that talked about her cupcake and talked about her cupcake and how her uncle liked her cupcake and the conversation was just, it was, you know, they didn't think a lot about it because it was, maybe it was even around the girl's birthday and they didn't think a whole lot about it. But this girl, that was her name for her body part, was her cupcake. And because of that, she wasn't able to communicate what was being done to her because it kind of got lost in translation. Yeah. And after I heard that, I thought, you know, we have to do that. That is important. And we try to instill that in families that we work with too. There's no shame in those real words. And obviously, it's like you said, I know you have to be sensitive to the age of the child, but it's never too early to start calling those parts what they are.
Exactly. I mean, we teach little ones, toddlers, you know, head, shoulders, knees, and toes.
Yeah.
But they also need to know penis, vagina, breast.
Yeah.
And that's what they're called.
Right.
And so when you start those conversations really early, then that child knows, and there is no feelings attached to the word elbow is any more shameful than the word vagina.
Right.
It's just part of their body.
Right.
And it's really important, like you said, that if something happens to a child, they can specifically say to their trusted adult, someone is touching my breast.
Yes.
Instead of getting lost in communication,
right,
that someone's touching my something else,
right,
and nobody really is understanding what's going on.
Right.
So that's incredible, incredibly important. And if you are a parent or a caregiver and you think, gosh, I never did that, and my child is 10 years old, you know what? It's okay to go back to that and say, I know we've always called it this, but I just realized today it's really important that you know the real name, the biological name for this. So so start today.
Right. It's not too late.
No, it's not too late. The other thing is having conversation with the kids about under what circumstances somebody can touch their body.
Okay.
And those are going to be, those should be very limited. Yes. And so if you are a parent and you are helping bathe a child, then you need to start having those conversations. You know, it's okay if mommy is helping you take a bath, but that's the only time that mommy or anybody else should be touching you. It is okay if a doctor has to look at your private parts. But if you want mommy or daddy in the room at that, then that is totally fine.
Yes.
I will say that sometimes child abuse perpetrators will use things like, let's play doctor, or will try to tell a child, it's okay, I'm your uncle, or it's okay, I'm your coach, if I see your private parts or touch them. And so when you talk to your children, I want you to be very specific on who is allowed to see them and under what circumstances. Because even a doctor, if you happen to be friends with the doctor, the doctor should not be examining or looking at your child's private parts if they're not in a doctor, a medical visit.
Right.
So being very specific about that. And the last thing that I would suggest is have conversations frequently. Because not just teaching the right names, but also if anybody ever makes you feel uncomfortable, I want you to tell me, if you're at a sleepover. So I have a child, he's 11, he's doing sleepovers now. Mm-hmm. We've had these conversations and he knows that he gets our phone number. Mm-hmm. And I have told him, if you ever feel uncomfortable about anything, you don't even have to tell me what it is. You just call and you say, I want to come home. Mm-hmm. And you don't have to tell me why. You can come home.
Yeah.
If something makes you feel uncomfortable, you call me. And if you want to talk to me about it, wonderful. If you don't, that's okay too. I want my children to understand that if they feel unsafe or uneasy, that I am going to be their safe person. Their dad is going to be their safe person. Their grandparents are going to be their safe people to get them out of that situation if we can.
That's great. That is great advice. All those things are so good.
Yeah.
I wanted to talk just for a minute about, just as a community, things that we can do. Like, obviously, my kids are older now. My youngest is getting ready to graduate from high school. But I think about the fact that I want to be supportive to parents and families that I work with. And what are some things that you think that we can do to kind of help prevent child abuse? Just as far as maybe we don't have kids, and our listeners may be out there thinking, I don't have, you know, maybe they have grandkids, or they know kids, they are involved with kids at church or school or whatever. What are some things just that we can do to help families?
Well, I think what you're doing with the podcast, this is a perfect example. I think as a community, one of the things that we need to continue doing is having conversations and learning about child abuse. And about preventing violence, because the more that we are aware, and before the podcast started, you and I were just sharing some stories about, like, generationally, how viewpoints have changed from, spanking in schools. That used to be an okay thing. When I was in high school, paddling was still okay. Well, now that we have educated ourselves as a community, we realize that that is not the setting. And I'm not judging spanking or anything like that, but I'm just saying that is not a good situation for a school to be disciplining children in that manner.
Right.
So the more that we learn, the more that we become aware, the better equipped we are as a community to intervene. And that's my big second point, which is, as a community, I grew up here in Kentucky. I grew up very close here to Litchfield. And I got subliminal and probably some pretty direct messages about being in the South and how you don't intervene with your neighbors. That message of, one, don't air your own dirty laundry, so that, keep family secrets secret. But then the other thing is, don't intervene in your neighbor's life. Like, don't get in their business.
Right.
But the reality is, if we as a community member see something that is not okay, we need to speak up.
Yes.
Sometimes people will say, "Oh, I don't want to call the, CPS. I don't want to call law enforcement. Yeah. What if they're not doing anything wrong?"
Yeah.
And my thought is, if they're not doing anything wrong, then those agencies are going to find that that individual's not doing anything wrong.
Right.
And maybe it's an inconvenience for everybody. But that's it.
Yeah.
What if, however, you make that report and it was right?
Yeah.
You could be the person that intervenes in the life of that child, or if it's domestic violence, in the life of that couple, and you may effectively give them the time and resources to help them get out of that situation.
And coming from a home visiting background, there's many times I have wrestled with something throughout the day and thought, what if I'm wrong? What if I'm wrong? What if I'm wrong? But I always go back to, what if I'm right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And if I am, then that's something that needs to be addressed and it needs to be checked into.
Yeah.
One of the things that I think is helpful, because I work with little ones who are less than two a lot of times, and something that we really try to talk to our moms about is something called shaken baby syndrome. And shaken baby syndrome, it kind of goes right along with child abuse, is that, babies cry. And sometimes they cry for no reason. And that no one at the end of the day sets out to shake a baby. No one gets up in the morning, a mom doesn't, and says, you know what, today I think I'm going to shake my baby.
Right.
But what happens is moms are tired, they haven't slept, the baby cries, it's inconsolable. And so I always try to kind of normalize the fact that, like, listen, when I talk to moms, like, listen, you are a great mom. But we have our limits, and sometimes we're tired, and sometimes we haven't slept, and babies cry, and other kids need attention. And the fact that that doesn't make you a bad mom, because you have these feelings of feeling at the end of your rope. But what can you do? What can you do when you start to feel that way? having a support system. I think, you know, being able to call someone and say, listen, can you come and get this baby for a little while? Mm-hmm. And not just babies. I use that example with shaken baby syndrome, but just with older kids too. Knowing when you need a break, knowing when you've had it, knowing when you just need a few minutes away. It's okay to take a baby, and if you know that baby is safe, putting it in its crib and walking away for a few minutes just to collect yourself. Mm-hmm. But as community members, when we know, if you know that mom that has littles and she is working hard and she's doing her best, offer some time to like, hey, could I take the kids for a walk? Mm-hmm. Could I babysit so you could have a date night sometime? Or can I do this or that? Like, as a community, reaching out, even though then we're past that season where maybe we have little ones or we're not there yet, to be able to be a support in our community to these families, and not look at it as so much. Sometimes we can be so judgmental and think, well, you know, those are, you know, you need to take care of your kids and that's not something I need to be involved in. But really, as a community, we do a great job. I was just doing some research before we talked about, before we met today, about the fact that, you know, having situations where we're providing pieces of those puzzle, especially for neglect. You know, we have a backpack program here in our county for kids to have food sent home with them. And we have great preschool programs, Head Start, the schools all have preschool programs too. So there's a lot of things our community is doing that I think are great. But I think if you're listening to this today and then you're thinking, well, I don't have kids, what could I do? Think about the people that you know that do. And tell moms, you know, you're doing a good job. Dads, reach out to them and encourage them. So before we stop today, can you tell us, what should we do if we do suspect child abuse or neglect, or even if someone wants to report sexual assault or needs someone to talk to about that? Could you just kind of tell us what numbers they can reach out to? And we'll also put these on our website, so those will be available.
Great. Yeah, if you know or suspect child abuse and neglect, one of the statewide numbers, this is probably the easiest one to remember, the statewide hotline is 1-877-KY-SAFE-1. So 1-877-KY-SAFE-1. Also, if you go on the internet and you just Google child abuse report in Kentucky, it will take you to the website and you can actually make a report online. You can type it up. So that those are a couple of options. If you have been sexually assaulted, you can call the Cabinet for Health and Family Services at that same number I gave you. You can also call law enforcement to make that report. If you are a victim specifically of sexual assault, or you have a family member and you're just kind of, you don't know what to do, but you want some resources, Silverleaf, where I work, is that is our service provision. Everything that we do is free. We don't take reports, but if you have a question and you don't know what to do, just give us a call and we will walk you through that process. And then if you're interested in therapy or the legal process, then we will help you with that as well. And you can look us up online. You can call 211 and ask for Silverleaf. But that's, there are people in our community that can help.
Yes, and it's such a, you all offer such a great resource.
Thank you.
For families in our community, and we're just really so glad that we have your satellite office here at the health department, and we have people come in and utilize that, and it's been amazing to kind of see that at work. And that those people otherwise who might not be connected, who don't want to travel to E-Town, can actually travel here. So
right. And I know whether we're talking about sexual abuse or physical abuse, it can be scary. It can be scary if you have been a victim to reach out and say, this thing happened to me. But I want you to know that you're not alone, that there are many individuals in our communities who have been victims. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you're struggling. We have lots of victims in our communities that are thriving. And that is our goal at Silverleaf, is that if you are a victim and you need help and you want to, and you sit back and you think, I'm not thriving, I am struggling, we want to get you to a place, we want to help you get to a place where you are thriving also. So call us. And the community here has tons of resources.
Yeah.
And if you don't know what to do, call the health department, call Silverleaf, and we will do our very best to get you connected to what you need.
Okay. Well, listen, it was great having you today.
Well, thank you for having me.
And thank you so much. And this has been another episode of the Grayson County Health Department Podcast. Thank you.